Today we're talking about developing dance, and this one takes a lot of different forms, and how we locally support works in progress, a variety of ways of showing dance so that it gets supported in all different stages in artists' careers, and then also the way we talk about the dance in process, so critical feedback, protocols, and all of that fun stuff that goes into kind of a holistic way of looking at dance and how it gets developed leading up to being on stages or around sites, you know, not just on stage. When the series started as a thought because of Sage's prompt, because of the big white wall, I first thought, well, let's get some people that are already talking about the dance histories here locally, and so put together an advisory panel, and that is Judith Bring-Ingber, Linda Shapiro, Nancy Mason-Hauser, and Cecily Marcus, and they have helped me create the different context for this format. And the format today will have a bunch of speakers and they'll introduce themselves. And at the same time, we're mapping the conversation because part of the influences is this network and how we all relate to one another and how our work overlaps. And so Kristen Van Loon is here to do the mapping. So you'll see that happening at the same time. And then the series is sponsored by the Performing Arts Archives at the University of Minnesota, and they're the ones that put together the slideshow that you'll see going on. And there are a few additional slides that I slipped in that the speakers sent to me. And so it's kind of a mix of stuff that's related to today's talk and just kind of peripheral fun stuff to enjoy. So just a word from our sponsor. And then we'll get started.
Hi, my name is Kate, and I just want to say two things very briefly. I work at the Performing Arts Archives, and this partnership with Michelle and the Cowles Center on this series has been a wonderful experience. It's been so fun getting closer to our collections and being able to share it with people who might not otherwise know about us or visit. One of the results of this project is that we've been able to digitize over 100 different objects from our collection, and we'll be making these digital scans available online and free and open to the public. The second thing I want to say is just to invite you all to come visit us. We're located on the West Bank of the U of M campus, and all of our collections are free to access and open to the public. You don't need to be a student or a scholar or even from Minnesota to come in. You can walk up off the streets. We'll take you. Come on in, see our collections, and visit us. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Louise Robinson. I've learned three things already today. One, I had the wrong title for this. I was nurturing dance, so it's developing dance, I think similar enough. Two, I have to introduce myself. So I'm Louise Robinson. I'm currently the managing director of Ragamala Dance Company. But historically, I'm old enough to speak historically these days, I realize. I moved to the area in the 70s as MICA, the Minnesota Independent Choreographers Alliance, was being formed. And I managed several dance companies in my early years, Nancy Hauser being among them, and they have some photos that pop up. And actually, the first company I managed was called Whispers of America Chamber Dance Ensemble. That goes back a ways. And then simultaneously, the Nancy Hauser Company and Minnesota Jazz Dance Company. And then I went to work briefly for MRAC in the mid-80s, and then on to the staff of what was then the Minnesota Dance Alliance. And that's going to take the bulk of my focus as I talk about nurturing and developing dance. I do have notes. I am in the middle of hosting 5 Haitians for 2 weeks, and they speak no English, and moi parle-t-il Creole, which means I speak a little Creole, but I don't know what language I would speak if I didn't have some notes with me right now. So this topic is great. It has a really broad spectrum of entry points. I will admit, because of my historical focus there, 2 days ago I found myself, it was not a good moment, I was going, developing dance. Oh, goodness, we're having this discussion again about the importance of developing dance. And then thankfully, quickly, I caught myself and went, no, this is good. It would be bad if we weren't having this conversation. That's when the trouble really starts. And so I do want to extend a sincere thanks to Michelle and the committee for helping us as a community continue this important conversation. I will say that there seems to be a lot of talk about, you know, focusing on the process of dance. And I will say my history, my context, my focus for this is a little bit on the spectrum towards presentation. And I want to say a little bit about that. As I said, I moved here when MICA was being formed. And at that point in time, it was really a challenge to get work presented. There was a lot of work being created, a lot of energy in the community, a lot of good work, but a very major challenge was to get your work on stage in front of an audience. And for a variety of reasons, there was no theater that was really focused on dance. And that's a really major difference, I think, from the community then to the community today. If you as an audience member thought you wanted to go and see dance this weekend, in the late 70s through the 80s, you wouldn't necessarily know what theater to look up to say, are they showing dance this weekend? Is another theater showing dance? You knew where you might go to see theater, you know where you might go to see music, you knew for visual arts where you might go. But dance was kind of invisible. We felt invisible in the community, quite frankly. And another challenge was the theaters that we did move into we're not really set up technically well for dance. And so as choreographers, not in addition to creating your dance and promoting your dance, you usually, when you did find a theater in which to self-produce, you had to move in the Marley, you had to move in the lighting equipment, you had to hire the technical director, you often had to even set up and manage a box office. And so one of the things MICA did early on was create a clearinghouse for dance, where they, and MICA bought a Marley and bought lighting equipment and had a person on staff that you could hire to create spaces in spaces that weren't really, well accommodated for dance. And early in the, I want to back up a little bit and say, you know, MICA, as a service organization for the dance field, obviously everything we did, we hoped, was about developing dance. And so there was a lot in the process of developing dance, but the presentation of dance, the other end of that spectrum, was very, very critical because of these things I've just said. It really was very difficult to get your work on stage and in front of an audience. Extended play is one of the things I will mention in just a few minutes. I've been talking a lot already this morning, so I'm going to have a sip of water because I'm going dry already. Just as MICA was being formed, there was an opportunity to potentially renovate a space as a performing space for dance. It happened to be managed by a place called Antiques Minnesota at the time. Miriam and I have a connection with that space way back. So MICA did do a study done to see if it could indeed raise the funds to convert the space and manage it for dance. And interestingly enough, the organization was told that we probably could accomplish that task. But as a very young and small organization, if we did that, that's all that the organization would become. That all the other programs we had initiated and wanted to work on would probably just be all subsumed into managing a space and a series of presenting series. And so the membership got together and decided not to do it, which I think was a very wise decision at the time. But I have to tell you, it was a very visceral, it was a hard decision. It was painful. It was just viscerally sad to make that decision, even though it was the right decision. And I feel that for the next 10, 15 years, the community and the organization was constantly looking for the space for dance. What space might we use as a space for dance or be able to turn into a space for dance? I'm being timed. That was the other thing I discovered. So fast forward to the late 80s, and I am program director. No, actually, at that point, I'm interim executive director for the Dance Alliance. And we hear that, and we're here, our offices are here in what was then Hennepin Center. We hear that what was then the current merger between MDT and Northwest Ballet was not going well. And as much as, of course, as we're always saddened to hear of any upheaval in the community, I will publicly admit that the next thought I had was, and what's going to happen to all those dance studios? And so the wheels started spinning, and several months later, indeed, MDT had to let go of several dance studios, and it did give the community the opportunity to step in and convert Studio 6A as a performance space for dance. And in the very first inaugural season, we had three performing series: extended play, short order, and bonus track. Extended play was for full evening productions of work. Bonus track, and an important element of that was that it was to be three Minnesota artists and two national artists, because at the time, the Dance Alliance and the Walker co-presented two NPN companies. And so, and that was a very important move at the time, to have Minnesota artists on the same series in the same space as these national artists. And so, and the name, however, comes out of the fact, because there was such a backlog of independent artists wanting to get their work on stage, that when we got applications for that series and had to make the decisions of who to present, it was excruciating. And I remember sitting down for lunch with Wendy Morris, and she looked at me and said, "Louise, how are you going to make this decision?" It wasn't just my decision, but of course I was in the middle of it. And I said, "I have no idea. We're going to run numbers. We're going to figure it out." And we extended it to be five Minnesota choreographers and two national companies. And I don't know what we were going to name it before, but therefore came the name Extended Play. Short Order was a shared evening, three choreographers, each sharing an evening. And one would think that that would mean younger choreographers that weren't ready to produce a full evening of work, and that was indeed the case at times. It was also mature artists who were working on something entirely different and just wanted to get part of it out there in process or as an experiment. And Bonus Track was a late night Saturday series that was many, many genres and disciplines and a little less curated and great fun. And then we also made Studio 6A available for rentals for people to self-produce. Now, I'm talking a lot about production, and as I say, the reason for that is, you know, we were as an organization very focused on helping the process of creating dance, but at that point in time, the opportunity to get that work in front of an audience, there were not nearly as many opportunities as there are now, and so that was really a critical need and something that we stepped into at that time. I guess I will close with, it was also considered unusual, very honestly, for a service organization to present its members, to be a presenter, and to curate the work of its membership. And, you know, it was a great need, and we were there to service the needs of the community. And so it was something we felt we just had to step into and find a way to make it work. But it was challenging, and one of the things that happened as we prepared for our first series is a story I want to share. It involves Laurie. We reconnected on this about a month ago, but Laurie was part of the very first inaugural season of Extended Play. And as part of the season, all the choreographers would get photo shoots, like 3 months out. It was a connection we made through Diane Waller to a photographer, and everyone would get a lovely, lovely new photography of their work. And so that was about 3 months out, and about 3 weeks before Laurie's show, she came to my office, knocked on my door, and I could tell there was something on her mind, in her heart, that she was concerned about. And I said, "Come on in." And I asked, you know, how's it going? How's the work going? How's it, you know, up leading up to the show? And she said, oh, the work is great. And then she looked at me and said, "But it doesn't look anything like the promotional photography." And I think, Laurie, you were very concerned about that and concerned if that would be a problem from our perspective. And for me, that just brings in sharp relief the tension we have, but also the opportunity we had as a service organization to present work, because we not only were nurturing the dance and getting it on stage, but it gave us an opportunity to educate our audience about the process and the product. And I think very easily, really, in our opening talk that evening, we talked a little bit about that difference. So I guess I hope I kept somewhat to time. And with that, I'll hand things off to Laurie.
Hello, hello. My name is Laurie Van Wieren. Thank you, Louise. Oh, I know, I was scared to tell you that at the time. My name is Laurie. I'm a producer and a dance maker in town, and I have been since the 80s. I'm going to read some things, and bear with me. It's a short history of me, because I am an independent dance maker, and I think it shows what has happened here in the Twin Cities in some ways. Number one, circuses and weddings. When I was 5 years old, I pulled in all of the people in the neighborhood and made them be in my circuses, and I also did weddings. So that's one. Two, my ballet teacher took me very seriously. I had a good ballet teacher, and he took me very seriously, and that was important to me. That was not here, but I think you all know what I mean. And then I went to art school, where I learned about performance and conceptual art and printmaking. I did printmaking because I had to get my hands on something, and not just, I had to get out of my head. Four, I started working at the Walker Arts Center, where I saw Merce Cunningham, et cetera, all kinds of people, and especially Grand Union. And then I also did my first show ever, group show and solo show at the Choreographer's Evening that Judith Brin started. So it was the Walker Arts Center and Judith. I also was dancing at Nancy Hauser, where I was studying German Expressionism. And what Nancy did really promote there is your individual voice. Six, Micah, where I did my first produced work, was really involved with the community, and I started a project called, with other artists, called Potluck Performances. These are some of the posters we used to make. I think I'm going to go back. This is Diane Waller made this poster. There's another one down here. But I like having my hands on things. And this is actually something I did at Nancy Hauser. I was in a show, self-produced show. I don't know, do any of you know about Nancy Hauser in the 70s? It was a dance center for the arts. I mean, there was dance and music and visual art, and we learned to collaborate and we learned to be artists ourselves. Where was I? That was Micah. Dance Alliance. And the Dance Alliance, the community became stronger. We had connections with national and international voices. It was a great community. 2003, so there's a big gap there. So 2003, I decided to bring, can you hear me on this? Okay, it feels odd, but all right. 9x22, I created to show work. I looked around and saw that there were no places to show work and talk about it, or there weren't very many. I mean, you could do it at Patrick's and couple other studios in town. And so I started in because I thought there was a need and I thought I could do it. Now, I was telling Louise this story. I set it all up. I thought it should be done. And I got up there and I realized I had to talk, which is just terrifying for the dancer in me. It was terrifying, but I did it, and I've been doing it for 11 years. And I meant it to be a place where anybody could show anything, any kind of dance, and my idea of dance is pretty wide, from the conceptual to the very extreme physically, and I think it's still doing that, still showing all kinds of work, and some people, I've been showing ballet and performance art and all kinds of things, and I still call it dance. Nine by 22. Nine. I worked at the Southern Theater and the Ritz as an independent contractor and a producer of work, where I learned a heck of a lot of things about an organization that was crumbling, you were talking about, it used to be very hard to produce work, self-produce work, and it was expensive, but in some ways, I think we're sort of back there. I think, you know, the Cowles Center is here, and I think it's great to have this place, but I don't think it's the flagship, and I think we need a lot more support in that area. So, the support that I've gotten is from my fellow dance makers, and I want to say Kristen Van Loon at the Bryant Lake Bowl, and Kim Bartman for just letting it happen over at the Bowl. I think the only reason it's still going on is because I never had to write a mission statement, and I connect with my community dance makers, yeah. And I think there's a lot of new ways to make dance. I think concert dance is kind of going out of fashion. Although I love it, and I love ballet, and I support all different kinds of dance, but I'm really interested in new work myself. And I think it's also still going on because I do make dance myself. So I think that's it. And wait, I should show you some of these things. And first I'm going to thank Charles Campbell for being such a big part of 9x22. He does the video. And let's see. This is the latest 9x22 with Penny Free, Roxanne, and Mad King Thomas. And this is one of the first flyers that I put out. We didn't use Facebook. We didn't have Facebook. And I'm dyslexic, and I spell people's names wrong, but I still kind of like these sorts of things. But it tends to look like this, because it's on Facebook, and I think I want to go back to making things. What am I missing? Well, I'm sure you'll fill it in. What? Scuba. Scuba was started at the Southern, and it was a touring program for dance in the country. And it was started by artists. So all these programs I'm talking about now, they were all started by artists. They're all artist-driven, the Southern and the Ritz. But Scuba was, and it's a program. It's still sort of in limbo, but it is Velocity in Seattle, ODC in San Francisco, Minneapolis. It was the Southern at Minneapolis, and then Philadelphia. Terry Fox ran it, Philadelphia Dance Project. I don't know what to say about that, except that I learned a heck of a lot connecting with my peers in the other cities, and I think it was great to bring people in. What I learned the most is that people love coming to Minneapolis, people loved coming to the Southern, and love this community. And if you want to talk to me about having that keep going, talk to me afterwards, because I'd like that. All right, thank you.
Hello, hello. I'm Miriam Must. I'm a co-founder of Red Eye. I know most of you in the audience. I think I've presented most of you in the audience. I shared this with the group when we met a month or so ago. But believe it or not, when I first moved to the Twin Cities in 1980, the day after I graduated from Grinnell College in Grinnell, Iowa, and I moved up, I had created one dance at Grinnell College, and I submitted it to the choreographer's evening, and it got selected to be presented. And as I told them, I knew enough not to dance in my own piece, and so I got my roommates to dance this piece, who weren't really dancers either. So that's my connection as a dance maker to this. To your world, but as a fellow art maker, I'm extremely connected and feel really that the dance community is my community. And I'm a co-founder of Red Eye Theater, and I'm a performer, but really an actor. And those of you who've set dances on me know that I am an actor, and that I will act your dances. Rather well. Over the years, we've discovered that community emerges from opportunities to perceive deeply, to think critically, and to make meaning. And this promotes conversations that you don't normally have in the creation and response to work. So one of the people in our program, our Works in Progress program, which we've done for 31 years, said, connecting with people from different art forms expands my sense of community in the Twin Cities. There's a really wonderful bond that develops when artists share a process and watch each other's work being born, crafted, and brought to the stage. And I think that's kind of where I want to center my remarks, is a little bit really on the development part as opposed to the dance part of this conversation today. What does it mean to respond to work as it's being made? And that's what interests us at Red Eye. And what we discovered was that a lot of the questions that dance makers ask are the same questions that theater makers ask, or performance artists ask, or that anybody who deals with performing is asking. And so we started to bring in more dance artists, and that happened historically. Kristen, when did you get, what was your first? When you did Hand to Mouth, what year is that? 94, yeah. So early 90s, we had been presenting in our Works in Progress primarily theater makers and performance artists. And then all of a sudden there was this period when theater artists coming out of school, the emerging artists, were really much more interested in classical forms, which was not what we were interested in at Red Eye. And so we looked to where the most interesting work was being made, and that was the dance community. And so we started inviting more dance artists into the program. And then for a good chunk of time, a lot of our programs, as I look at the Works in Progress and Isolated Acts, were primarily dance artists. So it's interesting how it shifted around. But what do I know about dance? Not a whole lot, except for as an observer, and that's what I think we all have to offer each other as we look at the work as it's being made. And so at Red Eye, we started asking, what do you notice? What do you see? What do you hear? And in our protocols, that's really what we focus on, so that we're not trying to make your work be our work or what we think your work should be, but really responding back to the work. When we, a few years back, surveyed some artists about what does it take to make new work, their responses were money, space, and time. And I think that's probably will never change so much. Already, Red Eye has this kind of glorious space for dance, and we try to make that as available as possible to people and are finding new ways to make it possible, whether it's by offering rehearsals to space to artists who we've worked with a lot over the years, or in all different ways. But also it takes the fourth thing that I don't think artists often say is it takes that conversation, it takes that kind of critical response as you're making the work. I'm going to stop there because I think most of you know these conversations, but there's other people. So there are three protocols. YouTube, hi. How are you doing? It's my show. There are three protocols that we use that we found really valuable that are the tuning process, a critical response process, and blanking. Kristen, what's the third? Descriptive review, thank you. And they're just, they're facilitated conversations that have, now I'm gonna talk to the camera, right? They're facilitated conversations that have that are timed, and the artist gets a lot of information where they don't speak back, so they don't get caught in a ping-ponging back and forth of remarks, and so you can take in all this information, then you have a little bit of time so you can respond to what you heard, and then there's a little dialogue, and then you kind of let the information sink in as it informs your work. And the results are proven time and time again on our stage and on other stages throughout the city, and I think that in how many, many artists in the dance community and the theater community have incorporated those practices into their own personal practices of making art, and that's our link. I do know statistically that 71 dance artists have gone through our Works in Progress and Isolated Acts programs over the years, and another maybe 15 artists and companies who we've co-presented or rented out for major performances, and probably another dozen or so who've actually choreographed work in our own productions. So it's really interwoven and really kind of hard to make those harsh distinctions between the disciplines as that kind of integrated world. Thanks.
Hi. it's fun to talk to dancers, and I just wanted to maybe have an invitation for people, if you want to, while I'm talking, to move your bodies. If you want to stand up, everybody, will you stand up? Will you stand up, please? So I'm just going to read this thing that I wrote, and I just invite you to move around or stretch or do whatever you want to do. If you don't like what I'm talking, you can curl up in the fetal position and... Anyway, no, but seriously though, just feel free to sit if you want to sit, but keep standing and move if that helps you, because you are in your bodies, right? That's why we're here. Okay, last year, my name's Molly Van Avery, and I run the Naked Stages Fellowship for Emerging Performance Artists at Pillsbury House Theater, which is why I'm honored to be here today with you. So last year for her Naked Stages show run-in, Pavielle French danced with an unleashed ferocity. Her whole life, she danced in private to her mom's records when she was a kid, then her bedroom when she was a young adult. She danced to work through her struggles with addiction, the loss of her father, and to brace against the impacts of white supremacy that played out in her life and the lives of her loved ones in her vibrant, tightly knit, historically black Rondo neighborhood. But her Naked Stages show was the first time she let herself define herself as a dancer intentionally, integrating movement into the stories and songs she shared in her performance. Was her show a dance piece, and does that matter to conversations like this? Pavielle shared a bill that night with B. Billy Zhang, a young Hmong B-boy who has a history and a following as a competitive break dancer. For his show, though, he came out as a brilliant writer, folding together stories from his life into a layered, non-linear examination of the self-loathing that emerged after his parents' divorce. Divorce is very uncommon and controversial among adults his parents' age, and resulted in deep divisions in his community. During his show, he would take breaks from the heartache and vulnerability of his stories and break dance in a pattern of knit red and blue lighting at the edges of the stage and his consciousness. These dance breaks became a kind of liminal space where he could express, explore, and digest the pain of his broken family, ultimately coming to a breathless and exhausted acceptance. So when faced with a subject developing dance, I want to introduce some questions to help both focus and open up our conversation. Who are we hoping to develop as dancers? What kind of dance do we hope they create? And who are they dancing for? I've had the privilege of coordinating the Naked Stage's Jerome Fellowship for Emerging Performance Artists at Intermediate Arts, then Pillsbury House Theater, for the past 8 years, alongside the insights, wisdom, and mentorship of lifelong artists Laurie Carlos and Sharon Bridgeforth. And this 8-month fellowship encourages artists to gain a deeper awareness of their creative process, equipping them with financial resources, professional development seminars, and artistic support all along the way. And as many of you know, Eleanor Savage began this fellowship in 2001 to fill a need that we're hearing a lot, that a lot of people in this room have filled their whole lives, to just create more structured programs that allow artists to push themselves, grow towards their potential, and give them a structure that they can draft, revise, and actualize a full-length work. So I'd like to try to answer some of the questions I posed as a way to illuminate how we approach developing dance and performance at Pillsbury House Theater through this program specifically. Who are we hoping to develop as dancers and performance makers? At this point in our fellowship, we're really proud of the fact that the majority of the artists we select have bodies or lives or identities that are not often seen or celebrated on other stages or are tokenized by institutions attempting to sort of diversify their selection of artists. So what kind of dance or performance do we hope that they create? Their own. And who are they dancing for? They're dancing for themselves first to reconcile, resist, and hold their lives up to the light. They also dance and create for the people who are looking for threads of their own untold, concealed stories to be played out in the light as well, so they may come to understand how precious they are and how much their lives matter. And while we don't put any expectations around artists creating narrative, identity-based work, Naked Stages is often an artist's first full-length solo show. And so I've witnessed over and over again the inevitability of the personal that emerges. So even if artists don't set out to make a piece about their lives, their mom and dad are never that far away and often come to the forefront of a creative process that's rooted in self-exploration and healing. So at the beginning of this fellowship, artists meet with Sharon Bridgeforth and are asked to spend time with questions like, who are my mentors and influences? What tools, strategies, and information have they offered me that I can use today? She reminds artists that our bodies, our spirits, our personal challenges are what we have to offer, and instructs that by looking consciously at our personal histories, cultural inheritances, and ancestral knowledge, we're more able to align with our creative power. So, how do we develop dancers? By opening up our worlds to wider, to include and give power to a great range of voices, aesthetics, and histories, to staying committed to vulnerability, risk, and support, and as leaders and facilitators and artists committed to developing bold, edgy, challenging, and relevant new work within ourselves and others, we must also develop our own practices and diverse peer groups who hold us accountable to political, racial, economic, and social awareness. And we must also find tools for ourselves to joyfully and creatively and consistently self-reflect and find new people and new programs that invite in a multitude of worldviews to blow our own apart. So, thank you.
Hi, my name is Emily Gastineau, and I'm a dance and performance artist. And I'm here today to talk about a particular project called Criticism Exchange. And I have I co-founded this project with Teresa Mattis, who's not here today, and it's been operating for just over a year, so a more recent development in this lineup. And Criticism Exchange is a critical writing initiative that functions on reciprocity. So essentially, dancers and artists kind of buy into this exchange, and they write responses to the work of their peers in order to then get responses from their peers about their own work. And so I want to share two kind of origin stories of this project. And the first one is my kind of personal light bulb moment. It was a couple of years, maybe 3 or 4 years ago, in a workshop with Julian Hamilton, which is a dance improvisation workshop. It didn't have anything to do with writing. But he asked the room full of, like, I don't know, 20 or 30 dancers how many people were writers. And almost everyone raised their hand. Maybe one or two didn't. And I was really surprised. And I really wondered where all of this stuff was going and what people were working on and how to, like, get it and draw it out. And then the real kind of origin of this was just my conversations with Teresa that we were both interested in writing, wondered what we could do about it. And we started for maybe 6 months. We had a kind of practice-based writing group. We would get together and do prompts. And then we decided that we wanted to transition it into a different kind of structure, the structure that is now Criticism Exchange. And the reason for that was that we were interested in doing kind of more substantive writing, stuff that could be meatier, spend more time on it. And then we also saw kind of a gap in the landscape for critical discourse about work after the performance, because having kind of grown up in this dance community, there's a lot of really excellent places to talk about work as you're making it, as you've heard from these people today. And then I'm sure every artist has felt this feeling that once you, like, after the show, it kind of falls off the cliff, and maybe you talk to people and maybe you don't, but we wanted to kind of work in that area. And then I guess just the background of arts writing, struggling or having a transition moment in general, and dance always being kind of the stepchild in that arrangement, or writing that's more heavily focused on promotion, especially for dance when you have short runs. And also came out of a belief that that the best people to give feedback about the work are the artists themselves, that really, like, trusting in ourselves as good communicators and the people who understand the work the best, I guess. So the structure we designed, as I said, people kind of buy into this exchange, and we've done 6 month rounds. We just started our third one. So it's very self-operating. So essentially there's a spreadsheet that everyone has access to, and people put in their performances in, and then they sign up to which performances they want to write about. And everyone owes one piece of writing when they, just like off the bat, as your sort of your entry fee. And then every time you get a response to your own work, then you owe an additional piece of writing. And then people post the writing to the blog themselves. It's just a shared blog. It's just a WordPress Google Doc spreadsheet as kind of like self-operating as it can be. And the we left it really open as to what constitutes a response. Some of them are more traditional journalistic like reviews or description, but there's we've also encouraged people to play around with form. There have been lists, there have been letters, there have been kind of like long, extended essays about what is audience participation. And we're always hoping that people will find it the right form for what they want to say. And then the group has been varying between the rounds, at least 20 and up to 30 or more people each time, but it's kind of built for people to be able to drop out because as an unfunded project, it can be hard for, you know, we kind of realize that not everyone is going to follow through and people are going to bite off more than they can chew. And I think it's also pretty conscious that this is for all of us as working artists, that it's a supplement to the work. It's not at the center of it, which is kind of a funny thing to say, like it's not a side project, but it's there to serve the work, I think is the point. So I want to talk about it too as how it functions as an alternative economy. So it is a barter system. You're giving something to get something. And I think I thought about this structure a lot, and I think it rides a really fine line because it takes basically self-interest, which I think is a pervasive and organizing principle of our society that is not all good, and turns it into something that is a positive thing for the group, I think. But it's tricky because it's kind of drawing on that that impulse that I feel is complicated. So what else can I talk about? I think that as a project, I think that there's a lot farther that it can go. I think the structure does a particular thing, and it's built up an archive of performances that that wouldn't have been there otherwise, and it's really in the people who have participated in it. It's allowed people to develop a writing practice and do it in public, which I think it was a new thing for me and a new thing for many people in the exchange. And I think there's more, like I want to get more out of the writing, and I think that there's more that other people can too because we don't have an editor. I think there's kind of been some comments that the writing is kind of too positive or maybe not critical enough, which I think is a hard thing to draw out of people when people are writing about the work of their peers and in really close dialogue. And in some ways the group is self-selected. The people who are in the exchange are people who are exchanging in real life and dialoguing in real life, and also making kind of work that's related to each other. That's another aspect of the self-interest, is that we really invited people whose work we respected and wanted to be in dialogue with, although it is open, and there's always been a thing on the website that says email us if you want to be a part of it. But that has not been used heavily. And I should say it's not all dance artists. It's also some experimental theater people, some visual art performance, queer performance, different kinds of dance forms, but pretty heavily contemporary and experimental. And I've been thinking about it a lot because I was just at Superscript, the arts journalism conference at the Walker, and I was struck by how visual art has this huge apparatus for talking about work, and that has to do with its own economy, and that there are people who are, there's like a luxury market aspect to it, which doesn't exist in dance, and so I think we have a long ways to go in developing that, but there's also stuff that's really different, and it's nice that it's so kind of scrappy. Actually, I think that was Kristen's word talking to me about it like a while ago. She was like, don't lose the scrappiness. So I think that's, that is important. Yeah, okay, yeah. I think that is an important aspect to it. Yes. If you want to look at the writing or look at the list of who's in the group, it's criticismexchange.wordpress.com. We have not even bought our own domain name. That's how unfunded it is, which I think it will, that's, as I understand it now, that's kind of the form that it exists in, and maybe the form will shift when a different need arises for dance writing or the landscape shifts. So I think of it as a temporary thing that's opening up a space for practice. Thank you.
Oh my God, I'm sorry.
Hi, my name is Anat Shinar, and I am a dance artist and writer, and I'm also project manager for the Performing Arts Department at the Walker Arts Center. And as such, I coordinate a program called the Speakeasy Program. So it is a post-show discussion that happens after Saturday night performances of dance, as well as during the Out There series, which is an experimental theater festival. And then this past season, we actually did our first music program, so that was really interesting to see how that worked. So speakeasies were first developed as part of a grant called Engaging Dance Audiences. And the idea was to develop programs around performances that would provide further context for audience members. So things like Q&As, the speakeasy, even receptions, extended program notes and blogs and things of this nature. So like I said, it's post-show and it's informal. And like a book club, the artist is not involved, so it's audience only. So people are just talking about an experience that they collectively had together without any sort of Q&A or feedback about what it's supposed to mean, but rather what their interpretations of the meaning was. And it happens in the McGuire Theater's balcony bar, so this bar setting is an additional way to make it informal so that people can grab drinks and come and go and just kind of eavesdrop as they want to participate or not. And in it, audience members ask each other questions and share their own interpretations without any definitive answer and without any intention of sort of trying to figure out what it meant. It also provides an opportunity to learn how other people interpret a work as opposed to how you interpret it. And so it lets you see how different experiences and different levels of theater and dance going allows for different ways of understanding or finding meaning in a work. And participants range from avid dance goers. There's one audience member that I recognize going every time we have one, and then people who say that it's their first ever dance performance or first ever experience at the Walker. So it really varies, and on average we get about 25 people, but for some performances we'll get 4 people, and sometimes we get up to 40. And it's great how it doesn't really matter if it's like a tiny group or a huge group. The conversation is always really engaging and insightful. And I was excited to see Jessica Fiala came today because she actually co-coordinates this with me. So the facilitators of speakeasies are a local dance artist and a Walker tour guide. And so Jessica coordinates the Walker tour guides while I coordinate the local artists. And the idea of having these two people is that the local artist serves as a sort of like expert on the form without being an expert on this particular performance or this artist's work. And the tour guide has training in facilitating discussions. So together, they sort of can offer an opinion, but also ask these open-ended questions that allow people to feel comfortable offering their own thoughts and also steer the conversation if it feels dominated or if it gets too focused. And part of the great thing about having no artists involved is that their level of knowledge about the work can really vary, even though we send them information like program notes and reviews and blogs and the sort. They're not under any circumstances required to read them. So just as an audience member might see a show without any knowledge of what's about to happen, that facilitator might be in the same situation, which can be really exciting. Um, So it gives people a space to ask questions without judgment and also be critical without seeming rude. And it's sort of, somebody mentioned the idea where like people are having these discussions after shows, you know, they might go out with their friends to a bar, and that's what we're doing, except we're trying to bring strangers together to have these sort of post-show discussions and just talk about their own ideas and thoughts around it. And really the big goal is to get people confident about talking about dance and to sort of increase their dance literacy. So getting people past that sort of phase of saying, well, I just don't understand dance, or I don't get it. And going beyond that to say, well, elaborate on that and talk to other people who might get it and other people who might not have gotten it. And so it's taking these blanket expressions and really letting people see that maybe that's a response to a particular work. And so in doing that, the hope is that we're developing the audience to seek out more experiences in dance and experimental theater so that they're not generalizing the field, but really understanding how maybe if just because they didn't connect with a particular work, that doesn't mean that they're not connecting to the genre. And that's all I got.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm just going to adjust this a little bit here, as I'm taller. There. I'm Charles Campbell. I am a founder of Skewed Visions, that is a performance company, and we do a lot of stuff. I'm going to talk about that a little bit, but I wanted to sort of insert my little tentacles into this map. So I'm trained as an actor and a theater person. I have a lot of maybe too much education in that, and part of that was being in grad school at the University of Minnesota, and there I met Sean Kellypeg and Gulgun Kayem, who also founded Skew Visions with me in 1990s, practically 1997, and our first performance was as a part of the Walkers Out There series in 1997, which was the rave one, because they weren't in the Walker building, they were in the Southern. It was temporary, and Hijack was performing that night, and they did the carrot peeling piece with a Dolly Parton, and then we did our thing in the bathtub, and that was our first performance. And then, to connect into other people here, a couple years later, I applied for the Naked Stages program when it was at Intermediate Arts. And as part of that, Morgan Thorson came in and just had us do some dance stuff. And I was like, oh my, this is really cool. And so I put some of the work that I had been doing with her into the piece. And that was a lot of fun. And that was in 2003. I did it again in 2004. And then after that, I was asked to be an outside eye for the next layer of Naked Stages people, and that was Elliot Durko Lynch, and I was his outside eye for that. And because of that, he said, you should go see this thing at the Red Eye. It's Anna Marie Sjogren is doing something at the Red Eye, and you think maybe you'll, because I was like, dance? I don't know dance. And so I did, and I was kind of really undermined by that piece. It was very exciting and very sort of, I didn't know what to do with it, but I was fascinated. And so I actually talked with her a little bit about how she made it and how she did it. And that was, not particularly illuminating, but very interesting. Anyway, and Elliot said, you know, you should go to 9x22. And so I did. And I was like, oh my God, this is people are showing work and they're talking about it. And things began to like percolate in the back of my head while I was, you can tell I don't have notes here, so I'm going back a little bit. The Skew Visions makes like site-specific performance is how we started, and it was sort of performance arty, and it was always very physical and very visual, sort of interdisciplinary type stuff. And where was I? Red Eye, 9x22. And Laurie Van Wieren said to me, "What, you should do a 9x22. I don't know what the hell I was going to do for that. It was crazy. It was, I sort of felt like that was never going to, no, I had no idea. So I said, yes, I'll do that. And because I was working on a performance piece later, I thought this would be a great place to sort of work out some ideas, not in terms of like, how do I do this particular thing, but like, what is the concept for this piece, and how would I like take this concept and use it to do it physically as opposed to like through language or something. And so that was the one where I shaved my head and my beard and chewed on the egg full of, it was very performance arty. And, okay, what came out of that one? Where was I going with this? I'm sorry. But then I was asked by somebody at the Walker Art Center to take part in the blog after choreographer's evening. And so I did, and I love to do that kind of ranting. And there was a conversation that came up on that particular blog about like the validity of different people's reactions and experiences. And because some people had said that they were very bored and they would rather watch paint dry. And I thought, you know, you can't say that. I mean, you could say it, but you know, you have then you know, you have to like deal with the outcome. And the outcome, in part, was me saying, no, you can't say these. You can't say that it's like watching paint dry, because these people, this is a particular. It's not like they're just making stuff up and they're going there and they're doing something as boring as possible. It comes out of a history, and it comes out of this kind of culture of performance. And you know, if you can engage with it and ask questions and sort of like insert yourself into that sort of bubbling community, then you can like take part in it and something can happen. And I was accused by somebody, and they said, 5 minutes, holy cow. They said, how dare you? And I was like, yeah, how dare I? That's great. So at the same time as we've been doing these performances, we started this thing called, I started this thing called Screen, which is where an artist picks a movie every month, and they show it, and it's open to the public, and we come, and we watch it, and then we talk about it afterwards. We have chocolate, we have wine, it's a great thing. And then we started How Dare You, which is where we go to live performance, and then we go out to a bar or a restaurant nearby afterwards, and we talk about it. And I say we, not just me and like a couple of friends, but it's an open thing, and anybody can come to it. But the thing is that through Screen and through How Dare You, and also Notes, which is about music or sound, and is there another one? It doesn't matter. There's a series of events, sort of peripheral events to other people's things. It's called, they were calling Petri Dish, because it's that kind of bubbling thing, that kind of culture and not just conversation, but like things are happening and you're taking part in it. And that was really important to me as a maker of work and as a guy with a lot of too much education to try and like have that. And so the thing that has happened is that people come to these different events and they come to a series of them, and the conversation that happens is a bigger thing. It's an ongoing sort of perpetual conversation that is happening a long time, and every time we have one of these events, we like hook into it and we grab into it and we take part, and it becomes something that refers back to other events and out to contemporary events, and like looks forward into the future. What are you going to do for the next thing? And like, and so it's almost established its own kind of like small community that's very loose and very open, and is all about keeping this sort of bubbling thing happening. And that's sort of my developing dance aspect. Thank you very much for the opportunity to talk.
I want to take this off because this is the point in which, because we've been telling our stories about what influences us and what's influenced our communities of dance, if you've got stories to share, I turn this over to you and you can add stories. Many people pointed to Kristen. Do you have some memories? Is that too quick on the spot? Okay. All right. That's fine. But yeah, you know, so when I moved here in why does that feel like I can't remember? 2006. So I moved here in 2006. And from where I was moving from, the level of discourse around dance was remarkable. And so this is definitely a topic where I felt like this, there was DNA in the community and it started somewhere. And so this is great to hear everybody talk about, you know, how naturally putting these values in their programming and making platforms for talking about dance alongside other art forms and in different spaces and at different points in the development became natural to this community. And it's really exciting.
You ready?
Yes.
Go.
I brought some paper if anyone wants to look at some archival materials, and other people did too, but something that Hijack did mostly in the early 2000s was a print journal for writing about dance called Watcher Reader. And I want to point out, if you look at them, the ones that are clipped closed are clipped closed because it was very specifically only the writers got to read it. So the people we were writing about and anyone else in the public was not allowed to read it, but you can look at the thing. And then the ones that aren't clipped closed were public ones.
My name is Judith Brinningber, and it's a thrill to have so many come to a program like this. I just have to say, it's very special. And I feel connected to most everybody here and want to thank you all for your energies about what you've done and are doing. I did grow up here, and when I finished high school, the logical thing was to go to New York because there was no outlet. And I'm thrilled that a high schooler doesn't need to think that anymore. But what occurred to me was that Mary Lee and I and other writer dancers, including Laurie, we had Wendy Morris and Georgia Stephen, Elizabeth Guerin. I'm sure there's some other people I can't think of right at the moment. We would meet at Walker Arts Center, Walker Library, because there was no charge for the community room. And we were all applying for grants where we had to write, and we were often using writing in our dance work, and so we decided it would be the logical thing to do to help ourselves. And like what Emily mentioned, we had prompts. Sometimes we would invite writing teachers to come help us. And I have to say, though we never published anything, there wasn't such a thing as online access, we improved ourselves, and that was a very precious way to look at ourselves critically and what we were saying about our dance making through writing. And so I don't want that way of developing ourselves being forgotten, because it was very precious to me. And in fact, I never would have written my last dance book without that dance group. And I miss it very much.
Okay, this is where I start calling on people, just because this has worked really well in other panels, and I'm just going to make it happen. Okay, so Lori's going to add something, but I'm going to tell you who I'm calling on next, just to give them a second. Okay, so Jessica Fiala, you're going to talk about the course you developed at the free community, blah, blah. Yeah, that one. And then Krista Langbert, you're going to talk about what Linda wanted you to talk about. Okay, Lori, you're up. Lori, what happened to Lori?
No, I just wanted to piggyback on what Judith was saying about the writing, which I miss too, and I was always intimidated because I would be writing odd poetry and she would be writing a book. and giving lectures at, you know, good colleges, and it was like, oh my God. But this is an issue I found. It's Minnesota Dance Extending the Play, and it was written after a, do you remember it? Yes. And I just thought Emily should see this other, you know, it was a lot of dance writing went into this, and some money went into this anyway. And that was put together by the Minnesota Dance Alliance.
Is anybody going to take me up on my offer? Yeah, come here, come on. Come on. Thank you.
So in 2011, the Walker presented a remount of Lucinda Child's dance, and it was in conjunction with an exhibit of work by Solowit. And so at that time, I was a tour guide, and then also the speakeasy was sort of in its early years. And so I organized a program which would combine some lecture with conversation and with tour and performance experience. So the format was a 3-hour workshop, and it was designed to introduce new audiences to postmodern dance was sort of the format, but it was open to people who already had a background in the in dance. And so it started out with sort of some lecture and background on dance history and influences, and focusing on Lucinda Child's and that performance with her choreography, Philip Glass's music, and Solowit's kind of projection component. And so we sort of worked on a little bit about the history. We did some responding to video experiences and dialogue, and then we actually toured the exhibit, and then all of the people who came were invited and given free tickets to see the performance, and then there was a speakeasy afterwards as well. And then that was offered through the Walker Arts Center for free, but then also it was part of the Experimental College, which is, I'm not sure how long that's been around, but it's basically sort of anyone can offer a class, anyone can take a class, and it's free. And so it's sort of a free sharing of knowledge for whatever your experiences are and whatever you want to learn. So it was a way of hopefully getting the word out there more broadly. And then one thing that I would like to mention from someone who's not here, but I think Emily was involved in this, is just Manju, who's since moved out of state, started open source dance a number of years ago, and I know there was a pilot year, but the idea behind it was that it was a way to, after someone has graduated from college, provide some kind of support and some sort of peer response, because you get so much of the support, access to space, access to peer reviews while you're in a program, and then you graduate and you're sort of on your own. And so I know there was some access to technology, I think access to space and responses, and he's since moved out of state, but I know that he was working on publishing some of that, so that's something to look for. And I don't know if you want to add anything about your experience in that program, because I know you're part of the pilot, right? I don't want to call on you, though. So that's something, that's just something if you feel like you have something to add, but another interesting way to think about developing dance.
Christy, you coming up? Yes, you are. Come on. You're half on your seat. You could sit right there if you want. You can sit right there.
Hello. I'm Krista Langberg. Kristen's going to interview me about New Dance Lab.
When did New Dance Lab start?
1991. So I kind of feel a little pressured because, not pressured, but obligated, because Linda Shapiro, who couldn't be here because she's in Greece or Hawaii or something, but felt it was really important to talk about the New Dance Lab, which I agree with her. And sitting here and listening to everybody speak and seeing these slides go by is kind of crazy, because I feel like, just so long ago. I mean, that's 20 years ago. It folded in 94, so it ran for 3 years. We were in Studio 2B, that was our home, and it was 6 dancers. Jane Shockley, who was also supposed to be here, who has strep throat. So that was my other ally in talking about the lab. She's not here, but Jane and I Robin Steem, Catherine Jung. I'm looking here because you guys know who these people are. I don't think you guys do. but I'm sort of like going back in time and reliving this experience myself. Michael Casper and Michael Engel. Six of us, four women, two men, for 3 years. And Linda started the program after New Dance Ensemble, which had been a repertory, very Cunningham-based, with Lee Dillard Dance Company. I don't know for how long that was, but it kind of evolved into the lab. The idea of the lab was that it was very process-oriented, so people, choreographers would come in, and they didn't have to finish a piece. They could just work on whatever they were interested in, and then we would always have a showing at the end, and we would have a discussion, and then the next person would come in, and usually it was two or three weeks. So in a way, it was sort of like a rep company in that we as dancers always had somebody new coming in with a completely different process and idea. But very different because it wasn't product oriented. So as a dancer coming from having danced with Xenon Dance Company before that, and then kind of worked on my own, did my own work, polka, for a couple of years. Like, two people know. But I saw my name on one of those choreographer evenings things. It was really so great as a dancer because, and kind of dancer slash artist, because I feel like at that point it was really clear that we were integral to the process, and there was a very much a back and forth between us and the people that came in. So mostly it was national choreographers, and I think there was one local person a year that, like, we worked with Susanna De Palma once. So all of a sudden we were doing flamenco, and most of us were, you know, modern, postmodern. So that was the idea, was how to, you know, she was experimenting with how to bridge her form with kind of what we were bringing to her. But yeah, I feel like just what I loved about it was, which I don't think really exists quite in this way anywhere that I know of in the United States anyway, which is that it was a way to practice performing without costumes, makeup, lights. It was very much like learn something. I mean, and at a high level, like everybody that was working in that were technically, you know, we were all trained and had worked, were dancers. I don't know how to say that, but... just, yeah, a certain level that we're coming to the projects with. And I just loved learning, trying, experimenting, and then performing it. And performing it like this, where you could see who you were performing for. You didn't actually maybe know everything you were going to do because you hadn't rehearsed it, you know, for months and months. It's like you had just done it for 2 weeks and then you put it out there. And there was something about doing that over and over again, so throughout the year, that completely took away the idea of like performance being like so intense and just getting into, like, even now when I perform, I feel like I almost get more nervous than I did then, because it was a part of what we were doing was the performing. So it wasn't like be in this separate world for all this time and then have three nights and show everybody this thing you've been working on. You know, it was sort of like this constant, so back and forth in that way. Yeah, and I think, you know, it folded because there wasn't enough funding for the company, because there wasn't enough audience outreach, which was sort of so disappointing because it wasn't about that. I mean, just sort of what Anat was saying about educating people how to talk about dance, I feel like that was part of it, because people would come who didn't know about dance and there was a conversation and you got to watch the process and hear the choreographer talk about it. But it wasn't the goal, you know, the goal wasn't like, we are trying to, you know, reach new audiences. It was like, we're trying to give choreographers and artists a place to experiment without the pressure of make something this long in this way for this space, but just like, you know, you could try something completely different. Like Donna Uchizono came and she brought in this performance artist from California, Rachel Rosenthal? It's kind of, oh, did she? Okay, she was amazing, amazing woman, yeah, and Donna brought her in and they collaborated, and so they collaborated and then we collaborated with them, and we took our clothes off and we ran around the room. There's some film footage of that, but I mean, I'm just saying that because that was like the naked piece. It sort of ended up being, just remembering it that way, but really just fascinating. And then Donna could go back to New York and she would take whatever she had worked on with the lab. And often choreographers would then work with their company. You know, so it could be a springboard and sometimes they would just scrap it, but I think it was all, you know, information for them. Yeah, Linda told me not to tell any personal stories. She was like, this is about the structure, not about personal stories. But I think just the, but just the kind of importance of in this conversation that time got recognized and what it was, what it did. And I feel like Kristen and I have talked about it because she came to a lot of the lab performances and yeah.
Thanks for putting up with my torture techniques. So just a reminder, this is our last of the series. We've been mapping them, and so the maps are around. Please come up and look at them. Kristen, do you... We want to keep doing this. Yes, we want to keep doing this. So just look for announcements, and thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Oh, documentation. I was thinking about 9x22 and Charles.
Yeah, there is a
videotaping app.
Yes. Yes.
Kind of want to make that
in the 70s. Bowser and a number of different companies study composition. Any improvisation class? Composition class for beginners, absolute beginners, dance choir.
This topic, I think, is interesting how this was coming up.
Yeah, the lay person was more involved. Margaret had us all doing studies. You weren't really allowed to be in anyone else's pieces unless you yourself had been making even
I'm going to write comp
studies.
Class.
Yeah, composition class, and assignments with improv class.
Comps.
Yeah.
The word comps.
Yeah, the composition class. And the thing was, then we had studio nights, and we would start with the simplest, tiniest, shortest studies by the beginners.
Yeah.
And then on up to the company, all the way through to the company. And we actually had a class
so
called
nice.
Gen Act class, which was advanced beginners, and all the way through the company, all danced together in the middle of the afternoon, and then there was the advanced class. So they, and I remember asking dance lines, what about general class, combined, inclusive? And I remember June Wilson saying, nobody has time for that anymore.
That's so weird. I love that.
Mishmashing like that.
So what I did is I made this loop with composition comp class, expert, non-expert, diversity.
And that's kind of like the German expressionist kind of American.